Next tonight, another in our ongoing series about food. Special correspondent Fred DeSam-Lazaro reports on the record drought in Australia.
The dust storms that blanketed Sydney in September were a vivid reminder of the drought gripping Australia, imperiling the livelihood of farmers and food exports this country and the world depend on. The 8-year dry spell has convinced many Australians that it's a signal of permanent climate change here. The epicenter is a huge agricultural area in southeastern Australia known as the Murray-Darling Basin, an area the size of France and Germany combined, named for Australia's two main rivers. Lake Boga, where fish, birds, and water sport once thrived, has been bone dry for almost 2 years. Ian Mason used to earn most of his income farming rice. Once a $500 million export crop, it's now virtually collapsed. He's had to switch entirely to wheat, a staple with strong global demand, but its return has been mixed at best.
This field here once had rice in it.
That's right, it's set up. It wouldn't have seen rice in this paddock for probably 8 to 10 years.
And wheat, which is a hardier, less thirsty crop, is also struggling.
Yeah, that's right, because we just haven't had any rainfall. It's already started to die off from the bottom.
More than direct rainfall, farmers like Mason rely on an extensive network of dams and canals first built during the Great Depression. It brought water and prosperity, and out of an arid plain spawned a food industry larger than California's. Farmers were lured by the promise of a reliable supply of water. They bought land and signed their farms onto the network by purchasing water rights. These entitlements added stress to the river system, but farmers like Ian Mason say they were taken for granted until the water stopped coming. This year, Mason got 9% of his allocation. It's still better than last year and the year before when he got no water from the canal system. Zero.
And the evidence of irrigation and no irrigation is plain to see here.
That's right.
He spent his limited allocation to irrigate a part of his wheat crop.
So you can see the sharp contrast between the two soils.
This one's got some future and this one's got no future, basically.
And the crop with some future must find a new buyer. He'd been selling it to neighbors who own a dairy farm.
Ideally, you'd sell this wheat to the McPhees so that they can mix it with their silage and feed it to their dairy
that's
cows.
Right. Yes, that's what normally happens.
But normal hasn't happened in a long time for Mason and his neighbors, Graham and Jane McPhee. They've decided to sell most of their prized cows.
We can't afford to feed them. We just can't afford to do it.
The McPhees' fortunes have declined steadily, in tandem with their water allocation in recent years.
The last few seasons, we've never had 100% entitlement. They've taken it back to sort of 82% and then 64%, and I think last year we're on 3%. Is that right?
That was the first time in 3 years we actually got an allocation. So
that's any water.
Facing mounting debts and market vagaries that have pushed milk prices lower, the McPhees had to sell one of their last bankable assets, hoping to buy some more time.
You've gone from one season to the next now for several, saying it's got to end now, it's got to end now. It hasn't. Have you visited the ugly scenario in which it doesn't end next season? And what then?
We don't like to think like that.
We're optimists. That's why we're still here.
I don't know, either that or bloody stupid, one of the two.
What farmers are is stoic, reluctant to seek help, says Andrew Gregory. He's with a government agency that runs the Drought Bus, a traveling one-stop shop for various assistance programs. Farmers weren't coming into the office, so the office went to them.
Farmers in general are very proud people, and this was a factor that we needed to address. So we had these reports in the media of some horrific numbers of farmers taking their lives. We realised that we need to take the service out to the farming community.
He says 27,000 farmers have popped into the mobile centres. Among various programs are grants equal to about $125,000 to get out of irrigated farming.
We're in the front line of feeling the impacts of climate change. And as it's gone on, it started to become, what's the impact then on the family? And that's having a very real bearing on some of the difficult decisions that they've got to make about their own futures.
Tony Burke is Australia's Minister for Agriculture, Fisheries and Forestry. The government has earmarked some $5 billion to improve the efficiency of farmers and the irrigation system itself, for example, lining canals to prevent seepage. It also has a $2.5 billion program to buy back water allocations from farmers, hoping to lessen the stress on the rivers and streams.
We pay a very big price for previous policy neglect, a very big price. It means we have a river system which is massively over-allocated. The environment needs a healthy river, and from the perspective of farmers, irrigators need a healthy river too.
Burke says when it finally ends, the drought will leave fewer, larger and water-efficient farms. Ross Nichols' 700-cow dairy offers an early glimpse. Water is carefully measured before being released by a computerized system of floodgates.
Every drop of water on our farm is retained on the farm, so it's getting recycled.
His pastures are hardier grasses that use less water. The fields are leveled by laser technology, so water flows evenly with no puddles.
There's probes at 10 centimetres, 20.
Probes measure the moisture content in the soil, helping determine how much water is needed.
We're obviously got to run the business with less water. So I guess a direct reflection of that is when there's less water available, the cost of that water goes up. So is it viable to use water at that price?
To survive, farmers will have to adopt new technology, use much less water, and look for market opportunities in crops that yield more profit on less water. Mark Hoden is an expert on climate change and agriculture.
What we've already seen is water rights and water licences moving from low-value uses, so for example from producing pasture for dairy cattle, through and moving into areas such as fruit growers or vineyards where there's a lot higher economic return per use of any given amount of water.
But Hoden says the total amount of water will never return to what it has been, thanks to climate changes caused by greenhouse gases. He says Australia's recent extremes, tropical storms and deadly bushfires, are beyond normal weather cycles. Ag Minister Burke agrees.
For those who hoped we were just in a normal cycle that was dipping a little bit lower than previously, it's not that. We need to be smarter than we've ever been before. That means we need to adapt to the new climate. We need to never turn our back on research and development.
Polls show a solid majority of Australians agree their country is experiencing permanent changes in climate. Farmers in the Murray-Darling Basin, like Ian Mason, are more sceptical.
I'm a firm believer that what we're seeing is climate variability, that it has happened before. There's been prolonged droughts. I mean, I have no doubt that it will rain again. I certainly don't subscribe to the view that it'll never rain again. It's just how we then prepare ourselves if it's going to happen again, you know, or when the next drought happens.
The key question is whether farmers can hang on until the next sustained rain happens. Longer term, the question is whether Australia can remain a major food provider amid growing demand in a world whose population will reach 9 billion by 2050.
Fred has also reported on the challenges posed by climate change in India and Nigeria. You can watch those stories on our website, newshour.pbs.org.